Hello everyone, welcome back to my class. This is Ruman Ali. I hope you all are fine. So in today's class, I'm going to explain you about the soil microorganisms. The different microorganisms are also present in the soil and how do they help the plants? We know that the soil is a main base that helps the plants to absorb the nutrients from them. So in this way, the microorganisms that are present in the soil, they help the plants to absorb the different nutrients that are present in the soil. So here in the soil, many nutrients are present, but the most required nutrient is nitrogen by the plants. So nitrogen is present as a nutrient in the air. 78% of the air contains nitrogen. So as the nitrogen is present in the atmosphere, it is present in an inorganic state, and the inorganic state of nitrogen cannot be assimilated by the plants. It cannot be absorbed by the plants. The inorganic nitrogen should be converted into some usable nitrogenous compounds, then only it can be absorbed by the plants. So this work, the conversion of this inorganic nitrogen to some usable forms like nitrogenous compounds, nitrate ions or nitride ions, these are the nitrogenous compounds. So this conversion takes place because of the presence of soil microorganisms. And here we can take the examples of Azotobacter, Rhizobium, Nostoc, Anabaena, and many more. So these are some of the examples of soil microorganisms, and these microorganisms helps in the conversion of inorganic nitrogen into the nitrogenous compounds, and these nitrogenous compounds are the minerals that are available in the soil for the plants to absorb. In this way, they are helping, the soil microorganisms are helping the plants to get the nutrients from the soil. And let us take one example how the microorganisms are helping in the nitrogen fixation. They also help in carrying out the process of nitrogen cycle. So here we'll take an example of Rhizobium. Rhizobium is a bacteria that forms a symbiotic association with the leguminous plant. These roots of the leguminous plants show some protrusions or nodule-like structures which are called as root nodules. In the root nodules, the rhizobium are present, which are the bacteria. So these rhizobium helps the leguminous roots to absorb the nutrients from the soil, and the leguminous plants is providing a space for the bacteria called rhizobium. In this way, they both are beneficial to each other and they show the symbiotic association. So here the rhizobium is helping the leguminous plant to fix the nitrogen, and the rhizobium is present in the root nodules of leguminous plant and they show the symbiotic association. So this is an example by which we can clearly understand how the soil microorganisms like rhizobium helps the plants in getting the nutrients and other minerals from the soil. And in the soil, there are many fungi and the bacteria are also present that helps in the decomposition of the organic matter into the minerals. That means they are also contributing in the conversion of organic matter into the minerals, and that minerals or the nutrients are provided for the plants. So in this way, they are very helpful. The soil microorganisms are very helpful for the plants to get the nutrients and the other minerals. So to know the importance or to study the importance of the soil microorganisms, let us see one activity. In this activity, we need to dig two holes or the two pits. Let it represented as A and B. So these pits should be dig out in your backyard or in the other grounds. After digging these two pits or the holes in the ground, we need to pour some materials in both of these pits. In the pit A, we are going to put fruit peels, vegetable waste, paper, grass, and some other dry waste materials. And in the pit B, we are going to pour, or we will pour, plastic cans, glasses. So all these kind of materials we will be pouring in the pit B. After pouring these materials in the pit A and in the pit B, now cover these two pits with the soil. And after covering, leave it for 4 to 5 weeks. And during this time period, you need to pour the water on both of these pits regularly, okay? So, you need to pour the water on both these pits regularly during this course of time. And after 4 to 5 weeks, now open the pits. In case of A, you do not find any of these materials present in the pit, because these materials are mixes up with the soil. That means the decomposition takes place, and this decomposition takes place because of the action of the microorganisms that are present in the soil. In the soil, microorganisms are present, right? So these materials, when we put them in a dig and when we covered them with the soil and when we pour water for 4 to 5 weeks, and after the removal of the soil or after we open this pit, we do not find the presence of these materials because these materials are decomposed by the action of microorganisms, and whatever the nutrients are present in these materials, they are mixed with the soil. So the soil of this pit A becomes more fertile. Why the soil becomes more fertile? This happens because of the decomposition that takes place by the action of microorganisms present in the soil. Whereas in the case B, the materials what we poured in the dig, they are present in the similar manner. Means they are present as it is. The microorganisms cannot decompose these kind of materials, and the materials that cannot be decomposed or that cannot be degraded by the action of microorganisms, that materials are called as non-biodegradable materials. And these materials are present as it is. Even the presence of these materials makes the soil deteriorate. It becomes more infertile. So the non-biodegradable substances are the substances that cannot be degraded by the microorganisms. So in this way, in case A or in the pit A, the materials are degraded by the microorganisms, so they are called as biodegradable substances, and these biodegradable substances makes the soil more fertile when compared to the non-biodegradable substances. So this activity shows the importance of the action of microorganisms in making the soil fertile and in providing the minerals and the nutrients to the plants. So this is about the soil microorganisms. अभी हम बात करेंगे सॉइल माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिजम्स के बारे में. तो ऐसे माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिजम्स जो कि सॉइल में प्रेजेंट होते हैं, उनको हम सॉइल माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिजम्स बोलेंगे. और यहाँ पर एग्जांपल्स ले सकते हैं एजिटोबैक्टर, राइजोबियम, नॉस्टॉक एंड अबिना. ये सारे सॉइल माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिजम्स हैं, और ये लोगों के एक्शन की वजह से ही ऑर्गेनिक मैटर जो भी प्रेजेंट होता है सॉइल में, वो मिनरल्स में कन्वर्ट किया जाता है, और वो मिनरल्स एब्जॉर्ब किए जाते हैं प्लांट से. So they are helping the plants to get the nutrients and the minerals. Okay, so here we'll take one example. Rhizobium ka example lenge. Rhizobium ek aisa bacteria hai jo symbiotic association batata hai leguminous plants ki root nodules mein. Theek hai, root nodules mein present hota hai ye bacteria. Aur ye bacteria leguminous plants ko help karta hai nitrogen fix karne mein. So in this way, the soil microorganisms are helping the plants in nitrogen fixation also. अभी हम एक activity के बारे में बात करेंगे, जहाँ पर हम दो pits dig करेंगे ground में. एक pit में ये सारे materials रहेंगे जिसको हम biodegradable substances बोलेंगे, यानी fruit peels, vegetable waste, paper, grass, etc. और pit B में हम non-biodegradable substances लेंगे, जैसे कि है plastics, cans, glasses. और ये दोनों पिट्स को हम कवर कर देंगे सॉइल से, और फिर 4 to 5 weeks के लिए इसको कवर करके रखेंगे, और रोज़ाना डेली इसके ऊपर पानी स्प्रिंकल करेंगे, वाटर स्प्रिंकल करेंगे. ठीक है, फिर 4 to 5 weeks के बाद में जब हम ये पिट्स को ओपन करेंगे, तो पिट ए में जो बायोडिग्रेडेबल सब्सटेंस था, वो माइक्रोबियल एक्शन की वजह से सारा मिक्स हो जाएगा सॉइल के साथ में, और सॉइल को बहुत ज़्यादा फर्टाइल बना देगा. वही पिट बी में जो नॉन बायोडिग्रेडेबल सब्सटेंस था, वो उसके ऊपर माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिजम्स एक्ट नहीं कर पाएंगे ये वाले मटेरियल्स पर. तो इसके लिए इसको हम बोलेंगे नॉन बायोडिग्रेडेबल सब्सटेंसेस. ये नॉन बायोडिग्रेडेबल सब्सटेंसेस जो भी सॉइल में प्रेजेंट होंगे, वो सॉइल को और भी ज़्यादा इनफर्टाइल बना देंगे. तो इससे मालूम होता है कि माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिजम्स कितने ज़्यादा इम्पॉर्टेंट हैं, और ये लोग कितना ज़्यादा क्रूशियल रोल प्ले करते हैं सॉइल को फर्टाइल बनाने के लिए, और ऑर्गेनिक सब्सटेंसेस को मिनरल्स में कन्वर्ट करने के लिए, जो मिनरल्स प्लांट्स भी एब्जॉर्ब कर सकते हैं. सो दिस इज द इम्पॉर्टेंस ऑफ द डिफरेंट सॉइल माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिजम्स दैट आर प्रेजेंट इन द सॉइल. सो फार वी हैव सीन द यूजफुल माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिजम्स. नाउ लेट अस डिस्कस अबाउट द हार्मफुल माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिजम्स. वी माइट हैव हर्ड दैट द पीपल्स आर सफरिंग फ्रॉम स्वाइन फ्लू, और द चिकन्स दैट आर प्रेजेंट इन द पोल्ट्री फार्म, they are suffered from the disease called bird flu, and this diseases can lead to the death of the plants and the animals. So these are the diseases that can be caused by the different microorganisms. So let us see the number of the diseases, or let us see the different kinds of diseases that are caused by the microorganisms in the humans. So there are many diseases that can be caused by the microorganisms, and some of them are typhoid, cholera, tuberculosis, dengue, malaria, smallpox, diphtheria, and many more. These are the few diseases that can be caused by the different microorganisms. So the different diseases are caused by the different microorganisms, and these diseases can affect our health. These diseases can lead to the death of a person also. So the different microorganisms are responsible to cause the different diseases in the humans as well as in the plants as well as in the body of animals. Now, how the microorganism enters our body? After entering the body only, they can cause the disease. So how they enter our body? They can enter into the body of the humans or in the body of the animals by different means. They can either enter from the environment, or they can pass from one person to another person. So in this way, they can enter the human body by different means, and the microorganisms that enters the human body and that can cause the different diseases in the human body, that microorganisms are called as pathogens. So these pathogens, either they move from the environment into the body of the humans, or they pass from one person to another person. Now, when this microorganisms are transferred from one person to the another person, so the disease which can be transmitted from one person to another person, that type of diseases are called as communicable diseases. For example, typhoid. We get typhoid fever when we consume the polluted water. The water, if they contain the germs that can cause the typhoid, and if we consume that water, then it leads to the disease called typhoid. So here the microorganisms are entering into our body from the environment. Here the environment or the medium is water. So in this way, they can enter from the environment into the body of the humans. Now, when we talk about the communicable diseases, then here we can take the example of tuberculosis. Tuberculosis is a disease that can be transmitted from one person to another person, and these type of diseases are called as communicable diseases. So if a person who is affected with the disease called tuberculosis, if he or she sneezes or coughs, then the air, when it inhales by the other person, the germs will move into it. The germs will move into that healthy individual, and then that person will also be suffered from this tuberculosis. So this type of diseases can be transmitted from one person to another person, either by touching, by coughing, by sneezing, or by water, by air, and also by the insects. Some of the diseases are transmitted from one person to another person by the agents called insects. So here insects are the carriers. They act like the carriers. So here we can take the examples like mosquito, flies. So these are the insects that can take the disease, or that can transfer the disease from an infected person to a healthy individual. And they usually transmitted the diseases like malaria and filariasis, and also the dengue fever, and also the dengue. So these are the diseases that can be transmitted by the insects. And here the particular Anopheles, female Anopheles mosquito, is responsible in causing the malaria. Okay, so this female Anopheles mosquito, if it bites the person who is suffering from the fever or who is suffering from the disease called malaria, the malaria is caused by the microorganisms called protozoans, and the protozoans like Plasmodium, these are responsible to cause the disease malaria. So if this Anopheles mosquito bites the infected person, the Plasmodium enters into the mosquito's body. And if this same mosquito bites the healthy person, then these Plasmodium can easily move into the blood of this healthy individual. And like this, the disease from the infected person can be carried to the healthy person through the carriers called insects, like female Anopheles mosquito. So in order to control these kind of diseases, or in order to control these kind of transmission of diseases, we need to follow the preventive measures to control the population of mosquitoes. So these insects like mosquitoes and flies, they are usually present in the stagnant water. So we should always spray the mosquito repellents, and we should not allow the water to stand in front of the gate or in front of the lawns. So in this way, we can prevent or we can control the population of insects like mosquitoes and flies, which in turn prevent the diseases, prevent the spread of diseases like dengue, malaria and filariasis. So this is about the harmful microorganisms that causes the different diseases in the human body. So abhi hum baat karenge harmful microorganisms ke bare mein. ऐसे माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिजम्स जो ह्यूमन की बॉडी में डिजीज कॉज करते हैं, उन माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिजम्स को हम बोलेंगे हार्मफुल माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिजम्स. तो ऐसे माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिजम्स होते हैं जो कि टाइफॉइड, कॉलेरा, ट्यूबरक्यूलोसिस, डेंगू, मलेरिया, स्मॉल पॉक्स, डिप्थेरिया, ये सारे डिजीजेस को कॉज करने के लिए रेस्पॉन्सिबल होते हैं, और वो माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिजम्स को हम बोलेंगे पैथोजेंस. माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिजम्स जब ह्यूमन की बॉडी में एंटर होते हैं और डिजीज को कॉज करते हैं, तब वो माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिजम्स को हम पैथोजेंस बोलेंगे. ठीक है, तो माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिजम्स दो मीन्स से एंटर करते हैं, यानी एक तो है एनवायरनमेंट से ह्यूमन की बॉडी में एंटर होना थ्रू द एनवायरनमेंटल मीडियम्स लाइक वाटर है, एयर है. ठीक है, और दूसरा वाला है एक पर्सन से दूसरे पर्सन में ट्रांसफर्ड होना. तो जब भी कोई भी डिजीज एक पर्सन से दूसरे पर्सन में स्प्रेड होती है, वो वाले डिजीज को हम बोलेंगे कम्युनिकेबल डिजीजेस. कम्युनिकेबल डिजीजेस ऐसे डिजीजेस होते हैं जो कि स्प्रेड होते हैं एयर के थ्रू, वाटर के थ्रू, या फिर इंसेक्ट्स के थ्रू भी. तो अब यहाँ पर जो भी इंसेक्ट्स रेस्पॉन्सिबल होते हैं ये डिजीज को स्प्रेड करने के लिए, उनको हम बोलेंगे कैरियर्स. और यहाँ पर एग्जाम्पल्स ले सकते हैं मस्किटो और फ्लाइज का. मस्किटो, पर्टिकुलरली फीमेल एनोफिलस मस्किटो, एक ऐसा इंसेक्ट है जो मलेरिया को कॉज करने के लिए रेस्पॉन्सिबल होता है. अब जो भी इन्फेक्टेड पर्सन है उसकी बॉडी में ये प्रोटोजोअन्स प्रेजेंट होते हैं, जिसको हम बोलेंगे प्लास्मोडियम. तो प्लास्मोडियम एक ऐसा प्रोटोजोअन है जो मलेरिया फीवर को कॉज करता है. तो ये प्लास्मोडियम प्रोटोजोअन्स को कैरी करते हैं फीमेल एनोफिलस मस्किटो इन्फेक्टेड पर्सन से, और फिर जब ये हेल्थी पर्सन को बाइट करते हैं तो जो भी प्लास्मोडियम इनकी बॉडी में प्रेजेंट होते हैं वो ईजिली मूव हो सकते हैं हेल्थी पर्सन के ब्लड में. हेल्थी पर्सन के ब्लड में मूव हो जाते हैं और फिर हेल्थी पर्सन भी इन्फेक्टेड हो जाता है. सो इन दिस वे दे आर स्प्रेडिंग द डिफरेंट काइंड्स ऑफ डिजीजेस. द इंसेक्ट्स आर ऑल्सो रेस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर स्प्रेडिंग और फॉर ट्रांसमिटिंग द डिजीजेस फ्रॉम अ हेल्थी इंडिविजुअल, फ्रॉम एन इन्फेक्टेड इंडिविजुअल टू द हेल्थी पर्सन. थैंक यू.